יופי, זה נותן לי קצת זמן. סדר משהו פה.
Okay. Are you ready, Rabbi Johnny?
I am ready. I'm just about to share my screen. Okay. Just bear with me 1 second, and Besimcha will be ready to roll.
Okay. So I would like to invite Rabbi Johnny Solomon of Midreshet Lindenbaum to share with us his shiur on the topic of "I Am Just a Melamed: Reflections on Teaching Torah" from Rav Soloveitchik.
יופי.
We're ready.
תודה, תודה. תן לי רק דקה. And עכשיו, we are now able to, בעזרת השם, share a screen. Can you see this PowerPoint? Is that all visible?
Yeah.
יפה. אז נתחיל, אם זה בסדר. We'll start right now. We're speaking in English. Just to remind myself. Shalom, good morning to all of those for whom it's morning. Good afternoon for all of those for whom it's afternoon. And good evening to all of those for whom it's evening. My name is Rabbi Johnny Solomon, and I feel incredibly honored to contribute to this 24-hour Or Torah Stone Global Learning Program in celebration of Rav Shlomo Riskin's 80th birthday on behalf of Midreshet Lindenbaum, where I am privileged to teach. Significantly, the topic that I've chosen to speak about, which I've titled here, "I Am Just a Melamed: Reflections on Teaching Torah" from Rav Soloveitchik, seems incredibly relevant to this program. Firstly, we are just hours away from celebrating Chag HaShavuot, and as such, it seems eminently appropriate to reflect on the concept of learning and teaching Torah. Secondly, Rav Riskin is a devoted disciple of Rav Soloveitchik, and so it seems fitting to reflect on the Rav's Torah legacy on this special occasion. Thirdly, it has been the Torah vision and Torah teaching of Rav Riskin that has led to the establishment and the thriving of the Or Torah Stone Network, which means that understanding the concept of a great Torah teacher is itself a great way to appreciate the incredible contribution of Rav Riskin. And finally, I too am just a melamed. In this case, I'm a melamed in Midreshet Lindenbaum, where, among other things, I teach a course on the thought of Rav Soloveitchik. As such, this is a session from just a melamed about a truly great melamed in honor of an extraordinary melamed. Now, having introduced myself, we can now begin. I presume that most of you know of Rav Soloveitchik in one respect or another. He was a Torah scholar, philosopher, community rabbi, school principal, Rosh Yeshiva, lecturer, author, and mentor. Moreover, Rav Soloveitchik gave smicha to close to 2,000 students, a number far greater than any rabbi throughout history. Yet on countless occasions, when describing who he was and what he did, Rav Soloveitchik would simply refer to himself as being just a melamed. Although, as Heshi Billet once put it, but what a melamed he was. Admittedly, as Rav Aaron Lichtenstein points out, Rav Soloveitchik, or as we know, he was affectionately known as the Rav, at times used this term with a note of conveniently feigned self-deprecation. Yet despite this, Rav Lichtenstein acknowledges that the Rav was a melamed without peer. And it is noteworthy that even the great Rav Moshe Feinstein was fond of saying that the Rav was the melamed of our time. What I would now like to consider is what makes a great melamed? What makes a great Torah teacher? Admittedly, I never had the privilege of meeting the Rav. However, I imagine that if anybody would have referred to him as a Torah lecturer, he would have taken great offense. This is because a lecturer talks at students, while a melamed learns with students. And just as the Rav saw the activity of Torah learning as a dialogue, so too did he view the activity of Torah teaching. In terms of Torah learning, the Rav stressed, and you can now see this quote, that the Torah should be seen not just as a book, but a living personality with whom one can establish an I-thou relationship. The study of the Torah should be a dialogue, not a monologue. Torah is a friend, and to become a Lamdan, you must look at Torah as an individual, as a living personality. And it's in this spirit that Rav Soloveitchik approached Torah learning. At the same time, the Rav often spoke about the dialogue that occurred between himself and his students, which thereby created, and this is a famous phrase, a great dialogue and rendezvous of the generations. Given this, when the Rav would teach, what this means is that two concurrent dialogues took place. The dialogue between the Rav and the Torah he was learning, and the dialogue between the Rav and the students he was teaching. As Rabbi Tzvi Pitinsky explains, Rav Soloveitchik regarded the role of the teacher as engaging in a dialogue with his students while delivering a monologue as they listen in. He'd be talking with them, but he'd also be talking with the Torah he's learning, that his students would listen into that conversation. In the dialogue, the teacher and his students approach the Torah as mature intellects discussing and arguing about its interpretation, while the teacher's monologue describes his own educational experience, during which the student listens in to the teacher's self-reflection. And in this way, the teacher imparts to the students the living experience of Judaism. Now, I think this is quite profound, because what it means is the Rav didn't merely speak over what he prepared. He was actively, authentically engaged in learning Torah, which students were privileged to be both witnesses in and participants in as well. Now, it's important before we proceed to emphasize the fact that when the Rav taught Torah, he also was learning Torah. And this too is a key distinction between a lecturer and a melamed. When someone plans to deliver a lecture, they have already precisely planned what they will say. And the only uncertainties that they have relate to the questions that their students will pose to them. But a melamed is different. And as a Rav once explained, I start the shiur without knowing what the conclusion will be. That is, I'm so engaged in learning Torah that I'm authentically figuring out what this Torah means to us right then and there, that I haven't absolutely decided where we will be reaching, what conclusion will be achieved. For the Rav, Torah learning, which itself is an essential part of Torah teaching, was a profoundly religious experience, which engaged the Rav to such an extent that he seemed to operate beyond his physical limitations and beyond finite measures of time. As the Rav explained, when I teach Torah, time comes to a stop for me. I do not look at the timepiece, the clock, or at my wristwatch. I just teach. I do not know how to explain it, but teaching has a tremendous and a very strange impact upon me. When I teach Torah, I feel the breath of eternity on my face. Isn't that exquisite? Isn't that majestic? And we should make it clear that the Rav, unlike many Torah teachers, would speak not just about passion, but he would speak passionately about his passions. For the Rav, the study of Torah was an ecstatic experience in which one meets God. In fact, he says, when I open up the Gemara, either alone or when I'm in company, as when I teach others, he says, I have the impression, as if I hear, so to say, the soft footsteps of somebody invisible. He comes in and sits down with me, sometimes looking over my shoulders. We all believe that the one who gave us the Torah has never deserted the Torah. He simply walks and accompanies the Torah wherever the Torah has, let us say, a rendezvous, an appointment, or a date with somebody. The giver of the Torah is there. This was the Rav. He didn't merely learn the words of Torah about a prior revelation. Every act of Torah learning was a revelation. God was there. Torah learning was almost like prophecy, but greater, because with prophecy, things are unclear. With Torah, though, you can achieve clarity. Chacham adif minavi. So this notion of learning and teaching Torah as an encounter with the divine is a central concept in Torah literature and a repeated theme in the insights of the Rav. And just as we're commanded to both love and be in awe of God, both these themes appear when reflecting on Rav Soloveitchik as a melamed. In terms of awe, the Rav explains on the base of the Gemara Brachot Chaf Bet Amud Aleph that a prerequisite for Torah study is that it be studied in a manner that it was given at Sinai. Be'eimah v'yira retet v'zia, with fear, awe, and with tremor in your hearts. In this spirit, Rabbi Kenneth Brando observes how the Rav had a reputation of being very tough in shir. And while reflecting on his time as a student of Rav Soloveitchik, Rabbi Riskin remarked that the film Paper Chase, which described the agony and ecstasy of a difficult law school class where students were sharply challenged and had to work up to be up to snuff, was nothing compared to Rav Soloveitchik's shir. He wouldn't accept a foolish question and could put down a less than perfect rendering of the Talmud argument very strongly and very bluntly. You didn't want to say the wrong thing. You didn't want to give the wrong answer. There was a sense of awe. There was a sense, for some students, of trembling. Significantly, part of the reason, I think, why the Rav stressed this dimension of Torah study was because authentic Torah study demands humility. And therefore, even in his classroom, he wanted his students to understand the notion of learning with a sense of awe and humility. At the same time, the Rav also notes how Matan Torah occurred mitoch ha'esh, from amidst the fire. And this was to demonstrate the great love burning like a flame, which is experienced in the study and the emotional connection to Torah. In this spirit, Rabbi Brand explains how the demands he made on his Talmidim were actually due to the love he had for them and to his commitment to being the best melamed he could be. So you had the yirah, you had the ahava, you had the awe and you had the love, but both emanated from a connection to Sinai, both emanated from the Rav's belief that every learning moment enabled us to connect to Sinai, to relive Sinai, to have a sense of God's presence, to have a sense of revelation. A powerful example of this mix of awe and love occurred when Rav Riskin encouraged a visiting friend to pose what he thought was an incredibly good question to the original interpretation presented by the Rav in his shiur. Initially, the Rav firmly and swiftly dismissed both the question and the questioner. However, soon after, the Rav, who as previously mentioned, was not a Torah lecturer with pre-prepared notes, but rather a melamed who is engaged in the pursuit of learning and the shared discovery of the truth of Torah, he realized he was wrong. He asked the young Rav Riskin where to find the questioner, to which Rav Riskin answered that he was likely to be found eating his lunch at a nearby restaurant. The Rav immediately walked to the restaurant, entered. He approached the student and he said to him the following: "You were right and I was wrong. Your question was a very good question. It undermines my complete thesis. I have to give a whole new interpretation next week. Thank you, though." For Rav Riskin, this event was a significant turning point in his life. As he explains, the Rav believed in us. He believed in our mission, and he believed that it was his mission to properly train us. Teacher and disciple would only impact and receive our eternal tradition in the spirit of impeccable intellectual honesty and religious purity. That for me was a defining moment for someone who was beginning to view his mission as a teacher of Torah. This was the Rav, someone who instilled a sense of awe in so many, yet also someone whose love for both the Torah and Torah students was unlimited. Interestingly, Rav Aaron Lichtenstein, who we've previously mentioned, not only a great student of Rav Soloveitchik, but his son-in-law, he observes that at home we have, hanging on the wall, one picture of the Rav with an engaging smile in his face, as if to describe that sense of love. Another of him bent over pensively, with a somber, almost brooding expression. As he continues, "In looking at the latter, I'm frequently reminded of Wordsworth's portrayal of the statue of Newton with his prism and silent face. The marble index of a mind forever, voyaging through strange seas of thought alone. Only not just a mind, but a soul. Not just thought, but experience. And above all, not marble, but a passionate human spirit." The Rav had a sense of awe, both towards Limud Torah and towards teaching Torah. But he had a sense of love, of passion, of emotion, which he sought to communicate. Yet, notwithstanding his tireless endeavors to share the awesomeness of Torah and to communicate the warmth of Torah, his acknowledgement of the two shalshalot ha-Kabbalah, of both formal compliance and living experience, the Masorah of the father, the Masorah of the mother. The Rav, in an incredibly stirring piece written in 1960, admitted that while he'd succeeded in communicating the former, he hadn't fully succeeded in communicating the latter. "To a greater or lesser degree," he wrote, "as an educator and teacher on the plane of gablut hamochin, mental greatness, my students have received much Torah learning from me. But I've not seen much growth on the experiential plane. I have not succeeded in living in common with them, cleaving to them and bestowing some of my personal warmth on them. I have fallen short in my role as one who spreads the Torah of the heart, and the failing lies with me." This itself, of course, is tragic. Yet for Rav Lichtenstein, this testimony is also part of the Rav's legacy. not just spellbinding shirim, magnificent drashot, and electrifying chidushim, but the candid recognition of failure. Failure transcended by its very acknowledgement, as he put it. Very few people are prepared to admit their failures, and far fewer are public figures who are prepared to be so vulnerably honest and thereby express both the frailty of majesty and the majesty of frailty. Yet by being so honest and by bearing his heart and soul, the Rav communicated so much both to those who are blessed to know him in person, as well as to those who only got to know him through his words. Rav Riskin spoke about intellectual honesty. Here the Rav was saying, honestly, sometimes I didn't quite get the balance right between Yir'ah and Ahava. As mentioned by Rav Riskin, a key part of the Rav was to transmit this Masorah in the spirit of impeccable intellectual honesty and religious purity, which meant that he felt that it was his duty as a melamed to connect students to the entire Masorah, going back all the way to Mount Sinai, and to train students to analyze the opinions of our sages, not as detached observers, but as active participants in the chain of the Masorah. Now, this idea is repeatedly found in the teachings of the Rav, but perhaps its most explicit expression is a following long but extraordinary quote. Whenever I start a shiur, the door opens and another old man walks in and sits down. My students call me the Rav. He is older than the Rav. He is a grandfather of the Rav. His name is Reb Chaim Briska. Without his method of study, no shiur could be delivered nowadays. Then the door opens quietly again and another old man comes in. He is older than Reb Chaim because he lived in the 17th century. His name is Reb Shabtai HaKohen, the famous Shach. He must be present when civil laws or Dinei Mamonot is discussed, when we study Bava Kama or Bava Metzia. Then more visitors show up, some from the 11th, 12th or 13th centuries. Some even lived in antiquity. Among them are Rabbi Akiva, Rashi, Rabbeinu Tam, the Ravid and the Rashba. More and more keep coming in. And what do? I introduce them to my pupils and the dialogue commences. The Rambam states a halacha and the Ravid disagrees sharply. At times the Ravid utilizes harsh language against the Rambam. A boy jumps up to defend the Rambam against the Ravid. In defense, the student expresses himself rashly, too outspoken his critique of the Ravid. Young boys are wont to speak in such a fashion, so I correct him and suggest a more restrained tone. Another boy jumps up with a new idea. The Rashba smiles gently. I try to analyze what the young boy meant. Another boy intervenes. Rabbeinu Tam is called upon to express his opinion. And suddenly, a symposium of generations comes into existence. Young students debate earlier students with an air of daring familiarity, and a crescendo of discussion ensues. We all speak one language. All are committed to a common vision and all operate with the same halachic categories. A Masorah collegiality is achieved. It is a friendship, a comradeship of young and old, spanning antiquity, the Middle Ages and modern times. This unity of generations, this march of centuries, this dialogue and conversation between antiquity and the present will finally bring about the redemption of the Jewish people. The messianic realization will come because of this great dialogue of the generations. It's such a beautiful quote. In this quote, we learn three profound ideas. The first, as previously mentioned, is a concept of learning as dialogue. The second is a power of a teacher to engage their students in the drama of the ideas being discussed. And the third is a message that Torah students need to regard themselves as being participants in a long chain of the Masorah. And on this basis, the Rav would often emphasize that it was his primary duty to teach and explain the Masorah. As Rav Aaron Lichtenstein remarked, in the Rav's thought and experience, his role as Moreinu v'Rabbeinu went in tandem with the second, that of Maturgaman. He once remarked to me that it is a basic function of Marbitze Torah in each generation to render its content into the language and categories of their contemporaries. At the same time, notwithstanding his loyalty to teach and preserve the Masorah, Rav Soloveitchik also emphasized the value of original thought. As he writes, halachic man is a man who longs to create, to bring into being something new, something original. The study of Torah, by definition, means gleaning new creative insights from the Torah, creating chidushei Torah. And it was his staunch loyalty to the past, while his absolute commitment to finding the new in the present, which made the Rav such an extraordinary melamed. I've previously mentioned how a central motif and the teaching style of the Rav was how he engaged his students in the drama of the ideas being discussed. And we see this theme time after time in the Rav's teachings. For example, in his magisterial essay, Catharsis, the Rav explains how the halacha teaches man how to conquer and how to lose, how to seize initiative and how to renounce, how to succeed, how to invite defeat, and how to resume the striving for victory. And when reflecting on the concept of teiku, which he learned from his father of Moshe, the Rav remarked that when a Jew learns that there are halachot which are ambiguous, then they will also come to the realization there are other areas that are also not clear-cut. In matters of faith, teiku will also be encountered. The greatness of Avram, our forefather, was that he knew how to say, Hineni, here I am, even though he did not understand the request that God made of him. The basis of faith is teiku. If a Jew does not master the concept of teiku, then they cannot be a true believer. What we see from here is that the Rav didn't just teach his students how to understand the Torah. Instead, the Rav taught his students how to understand life. I've repeatedly mentioned in this year how the Rav referred to himself as a melamed. And I've noted that he would often say that he's just a melamed. Yet having considered what the Rav achieved as a teacher and his approach as a melamed, it seems strange that he employed the word just. But once we reflect on the final insight of the Rav, perhaps this term will make sense. Basing himself on the Rambam in Hilchot Talmud Torah, who explains that every teacher should teach Torah like God, Rav Soloveitchik explains that we think that there are many teachers of Torah. There is really only one Rebbe, one Rosh Hashiva, one teacher, the Melamed Torah Le'amo Yisrael. The voice of the Holy One resonates within the voice of every teacher of Torah. The Master of the Universe was our teacher at Sinai and remains our teacher throughout the generations. What this means is that as a Melamed, Rav Soloveitchik was doing the work of God. And given that God is the ultimate Melamed, and given the Rav's perpetual awareness of God's presence in his study and teaching of God, he could never be more than just a melamed. Still, as previously mentioned, but what a melamed he was. As a Torah teacher who has been blessed to learn and teach some of the Torah of the Rav, I strive to emulate some of the extraordinary qualities of him as a melamed. And as somebody who is privileged to work in a Torah institution founded by Rav Riskin, a truly extraordinary melamed in his own right, I can only hope that what I've shared and taught in this short session is worthy. I wish you all Chag Sameach.
Thank you very much, Rabbi Johnny, for the beautiful words from Rav Soloveitchik. We have around 1 minute. David. If anyone has a question, they can raise their hand on the Zoom or write in the chat.
And...
Okay, looks like we're all set. So thank you very much, Rav Johnny. Hope you have a Chag Sameach and a good day.
You are the cult of.
Okay.